So, hello, folks. Thank you, everyone, for making it on a Saturday morning and just before the holiday season kicks in. Myself, Jatin Goyal, I have come with 5+ years of industry experience working on a variety of products ranging from tools and automation, cloud services, REST API, programmatic advertising, and on-premise products, including some Google OAuth integrations. And talking about my personal passion, it's one of its is community building. So as Bhavin already mentioned, I have been part of the Hyderabad Python user group for almost 3 years now, and part of the organizing team for PyCon India 2018, PyCon Hyderabad 2019, PyCon India 2020, and PyCon Hyderabad 2020, which just happened as recent as 2 weeks back. Moving on, memory management in Python. So a lot of you will wonder, why should you care about memory management when you're writing a Python program? It's already too simple, and it's designed like a readability perspective and easier to maintain. So that is those are the let's talk about the Zen of Python. So those are the principles on which Python is laid, so that it's easier to consume, it's easier to write programs into. But a lot of times, if we don't care about memory management, it ends up like deadlocks or too much memory consumption. So first thing, knowing about memory management helps you write efficient code. And when we talk about efficiency, a lot of people have different perspective to it, but it just means one thing, that everyone is able to understand that same Python application, plus also able to contribute to it and without causing too much inefficiency in terms of CPU consumption and memory consumption. So knowing about Python memory management in the terms of efficiency, it helps you to write better code because you know when and where you should do the object initialization or assign some new memory so that your program does not grow dynamically or exponentially. Moving on. So we just covered this part. Now you know why you should care, so that when your applications are running in production environment, you sometimes have limited, you'll definitely have a lot of resources allocated to you in terms of CPU and memory, but you don't want to overburden that system. You definitely don't want to install a 16 or let's say 128 GB RAM on a server if your job can be done with 32 GB. You definitely don't want to increase those production costs. First, let's rewind back. Let's talk about variables. And I'll talk about, quickly go back to C. So this talk, again, just a disclaimer, this talk is mostly based on C Python, the Python implementation in C language. So the most common version that is daily used in our day-to-day use. So let's talk about C style variables, how the initialization used to happen is. We have the declaration where we have the data type, the variable name, and the value that is being assigned to it. So int a equals 10, b equals, a equals 5, and int b equals 10. What does it actually mean inside the memory? So when we say that int a equals 5, C program, it will go into the memory, assign a location to it. There is the pointer that is assigned to variable a, and the value is stored in binary format. So a has its location, and the value stored at that location is 0101, and similarly b. So it's, again, once we have declared the variable, it's fixed size and same type. So you cannot say int a equals 5 and then change a equals some string abc. It will just throw you an error during compilation. So now let's say I want to update the variable a equals 15, or I have some multiplication, division, some operation happening, and value of a variable has changed. What does it actually mean in memory? What does it do? It says that it checks the pointer that is the memory location that is assigned to it. So it goes to that memory location and it updates that value. But so it does not make any changes apart from that, right? So it just, we talked, the value is updated, but it doesn't mean that the variable is updated in place. So it was only, it was earlier storing a integer value. Now also it is storing an integer value. Just the memory location, the value is updated and only in the binary format. Moving on, I know this question, so some of you can let your answers know in the chat. How many types of variables do you think are there in the Python in Python language? If you thought two, three int, int string dictionary, actually there are none. So yes, actually, Python does not have any concept of variables. It's just a naming that we have. But rewind back, Python, we always used to read that everything in Python is an object. So when you say a equals 5 in Python, it just creates an object which contains the value, which is of type integer and contains the value 5. So basically, that also is an object. Python has names. So what names actually means is Python has names, names which have the references to those objects. So when I say a equals 5, Python creates in memory, Python creates an object which is of type integer, just for its introduction. So it's C Python again, right? So it just maps a data type to that object that it's of type integer. The value is 5, and this is its reference, which will be assigned to the name that I have given a, which we call as variable in Python as well. So how many type of objects? Basically two type of objects. So one is simple objects. There is numbers, strings, integer, float. When I say numbers, it includes integers, float, double, long, all kind of big int, everything you can think of. And then strings, characters, and container objects are like, which can contain multiple container objects or simple objects, which includes dictionary. You can have any type of key. When I say key, it's like hashable key, so only tuples. You cannot have list as a key for dictionary. So dictionaries, lists, and any user-defined classes, those are containers. User-defined classes, you can have n number of variables, so it is actually acting as a container. How are objects stored in Python? So Python uses two data structures, stacks and heaps. Stacks are used for storing all the variables and functions, so what are being called. And heap is what is, so stack, when you say, let's say a equals 5, a gets pushed to the stack. Heap is actually used for storing the actual value. So the heap will contain the object that has the value 5, so that you can have multiple names in the stack, but we'll get to this, so how it stores only single object. So what do we mean by references? Sorry about that break. References, what does that mean? So when we talked about like object is created in memory and object has like data type associated to it and what is the value associated to it. And we talked about the name that is like a what we gave and it has a reference to that object. So it's basically meaning that it is storing that how many names are referring to a single object. So name or container that points to another object, as we talk, it can not only be a name. So let's say you give a equals 5, and you went to a list, you did list xyz equals, first value at index 0 is 5. So that also is like same object, 5 is already there in memory of integer type, and that object now it has two references. One is the name A, second is the list index 0, which is also referring to that same object. So that's how we maintain a reference count, like how many references are there for this object. Let's quickly talk about it. So when we do this x equals 10, we see x is a name that is created and it will go into Python stack. 10 is an object that is 10 is an object that is created with data type of int, value is 10. And that is pushed into Python heap inside the Python program. And the reference is for that object 10 is set to 1. Now, when I do y equals 10, it does not create in memory, it does not create any new object. Let's say it won't create a second object which has the same value 10. It sees that there is already an object with that value. It will increase the reference count for that. Now, when I do z, create a list. Now that also both indices, it has two values, 0 and 10, and 10 at both indices 0 and 1. So again, the same object, but the reference count increases further by 2. So object is there in memory, which value 10. Now its reference count is an additional field, which count has gone to 4. Now how do we decrease the reference count? As we already talked about how we can increase the reference count for an object. Now how do we decrease the reference count is, first, there are multiple ways about it. First way is change the reference. x equals abc. Now the x name was already there, but I have changed that name to assign to some other object in memory. So when I did x equals abc, it's the first time initialization. So Python will go in memory, create an object, a data type string, and value is abc, and change the name reference for x to point to this new object. Similarly for y. So now the references for the object 10 has actually increased, decreased by 2. Next thing is use the del keyword. So a lot of us must have used the del keyword in our programs when, let's say, you created some object, you wanted to create it temporarily, or you wanted to release back that memory to the OS. OS. What you end up used as was del x, or like delete that object. But does it actually delete that object? It does not. It just decreases the reference count of that object that was being referred to by that name. So when I say delete x, it just deletes the reference count to 10 that was coming from x. It does not delete that object. It only removes the name as a reference to that object. Third way is going out of scope. So this test function is there. I just initialized x equals 10. So that time I created an object 10, which has a name x being referring to it, and the reference count is only 1. After I finish the function, the variable goes out of scope. So the object is no longer required. Python's garbage collector will kick in. It will see that there was an object 10 in memory, but there are no references to it. So I can safely remove it and collect that memory. So what happens when there are no references, like we just removed all this, so it can be removed from memory. But so that garbage collector automatically kicks in and it will collect that memory of that object. So just want to take some time, rewind what we have already discussed. So that's why we know that how the reference count goes up when you have objects in global namespace, or like whichever namespace you have the objects in, when you are referring to that objects, the reference count goes up. And that till the reference count comes down to 0, the object cannot be garbage collected. So that's why local versus global namespace. So what basically happens to objects created in global namespace? They never go out of scope, because the Python program, they are already defined in global namespace. You have not removed them till the program ends, right? So that reference count never reaches 0. And that's why it's best practice, that you put avoid putting large or complex objects in the global namespace. Moving on, this is how a Python object in CPython looks like. We have a class struct over there, PyObject, which stores three values. First is the type, that is integer. Then the reference count as a value, integer value, that how much is the reference count, and the value of that object. This whole table, what I'm showing, type, reference count, and value are the keys. These are the values of those keys, and this is how the PyObject struct looks like. Just a small proof of concept that I've designed over here. So I do x equals 10, y equals 10, and this is the object on the right side. You see, this is the object looks like, type integer, reference count 2, value equals 10. So x and y are two references, two names. There are two references, but a single object in memory. So when I do x equals equals y, it checks for the value for those references. It basically says 10 equals 10, it matches. But when I do x is y, is this the equality check for the memory location? X equal equal y was the check for the value. X is y checks whether the memory of both these names are the same or not. And the proof is, so both of them return true. ID is a Python built-in variable function to get the memory address of that variable, of that name. So both of them, x and y, return the same value. This brings us to interning. So what we talked about, like, it just creates a single object in memory. Python does it by default using interning. So interning is a process where it like immutable objects, which have like integer or string, with whenever we are initializing those objects for the first time, it will see that this is an immutable object. So integer, like we cannot change its value after it has been defined. Similarly for string, if we try to change it, it just gives us the error, right? That unable to change the immutable object, and we end up creating a new string from that existing string using, let's say, substring or concatenation, but string at the end of the day, it's immutable. So it will interning, Python interning will only work for immutable objects. It just once there is a first time initialization, it will create an entry of that object, let's say in its memory, that this object, I have already seen it. This is the reference that I have assigned to it. So if in future there are any other objects that are coming in, that Python, that the program is requesting, and this it has the same value, I can give the reference to the same existing object. Python does it by default as a memory optimization technique, but it does, so interning also happens only for ASCII objects. It does not happen for non-ASCII characters. So let's say you're doing string interning, you want to do interning for, let's say you have string hello world, it will do that by default. But if you include an exclamation towards the end, it will not intern those objects, because it just, as I said, again, for ASCII characters only. And if you want to intern some complex string yourself, you'll have to use a system module built in sys.intern. Here's the example. So I just have x equals height pi, y equals height pi, id of x and y both matches. The value also matches equal equal y, and x is y, the memory references also matches. But I just include one exclamation, it does not work, because it does not intern any complex objects. If I want to do it manually, I'll have to do x equals sys.intern, y equals sys.intern. So sys.intern will intern that object. I have given it a command that you should intern this. And when I try to do the check, it returns true. And the ID of both objects is the same. Now the pros is it definitely reduces the overall memory. So you have multiple objects you want to intern, you can use it, and it will reduce the overall memory because it will only create one object in the Python heap. But it definitely includes some CPU overhead, because you're doing it on multiple times, let's say. So every time you run intern, it will take some CPU cycles. Even if it's a multi-threaded application, Python's global interpreter lock is still there. So only one thread will execute at a time. So it will definitely add some small CPU overhead. It can be small or large. It depends on the how we are utilizing it. Then use only, it should only be used when there are a lot of repetitive strings and you have, let's say, a single string that is going to be used at 10 different locations, and you don't want to have those 10 different memory objects, you can use interning over there. But if there are no repetitive strings or like no repetitive objects, then you may end up creating more memory than you need, because whenever you're interning, it will do some memory allocation on its side as well, Python heap as well, not just the object. Moving on, let's talk about garbage collection. What is garbage collection? It is actually a Python program that will automatically release memory when an object taking up that space is no longer in use. There are two types of garbage collection. One is reference counting, second is tracing. So we already talked about reference counting, how it stores like the reference of each object, increases and decreases those references. So we add or remove references, remove the object from memory when the ref count is zero. So as soon as a reference counting garbage collector kicks in, it will see scan through all the objects in Python heap. Whichever object's reference count is zero, it will collect those objects. So it just does not remove that single object. It has a cascading effect as well. So let's say you were referring to some object. Just a small example, let's say you have multiple objects and you're referring, let's say you created a dictionary and you did ID equal, let's say key ABC equals the value A. So you just gave the reference A itself. You didn't give the value 10, you just gave A. So when you remove that reference, it will just decrease all those reference counts. It can do parent objects as well, it will check. So if there are no references to that, it will remove those objects as well. The good, it's easier to implement, objects are immediately deleted. But the bad is it has some memory overhead, because it has to store the reference count for every object. It also has some execution overhead, because it needs to update the reference count on every assignment or change at any time. It does have a challenge to itself, like it does not detect cyclical references. This is a small example that I have. So let's say we talk about tree or graph. We have a node and the value, and what is its child? I create a node that is root, and its value is root. left, right. I said Root's child being left, left child is right, but right has a child back to left. So right and left have a cyclical reference to each other. This is how it looks like. Let's say root, I created an object node root. So this is the object node, which has the value root. Its reference count is one, which is their name root. Then we have left and right. So root dot child left. First is the reference count for left is the name left that we have given. Second is root dot child equals left. So the root dot child also refers to this object. Third is right dot child equals left. So this is like three reference counts. For right, there are only two, one being the right name itself, and left dot child equals right. That is the second reference. Now, when I remove all these objects, let's say reference, so delete root, delete left, delete right. I deleted this name, it removed this. I deleted left, it removed that. So root was deleted. So root dot child also reference was deleted. Left was deleted, but there exists a reference right dot child equals left. Similarly for right, I deleted right name. So right was deleted, but left dot child equals right still remains. So reference to root is deleted, reference count becomes zero, root is deleted, its child reference count to left is decreased by one. But so if we all still see that left and right still have one reference assigned to it. So whenever the reference count garbage collector kicks in, it will only collect the root object. Next comes the second type of garbage collection, that is tracing. It uses mark and sweep algorithm. So we already have a garbage collector root, that this is the entry point of our Python heap, from where we have the heap where all the Python objects are created. It will start from there. It will try to reach all, mark all the objects that it can reach in the Python heap. So it just marks them in the marking stage. Second stage is sweep. So it sees that these objects are already reachable from this garbage collector root, but the rest of the objects which were not reachable, let's say these two objects on the bottom left corner are, let's say, the left and right childs. It has a reference to each other. So they are not reachable from any other object. We can safely remove them because they are basically not reachable from the Python program, even though they can reach to each other. So what does Python use? It uses two types of garbage collection. One is reference counting. Second is generational garbage collection, which is a type of tracing garbage collection. So what is generational garbage collection? It has, based on the theory that most objects die young, it basically maintains three generations of Python objects, generation zero, generation one, generation two. Generation zero is the one that is again, most objects are stored in generation zero. So the concept is like when you create objects in Python program, most of the times you're creating it for a smaller period of time that you just want to use it for a small function. After the function is finished, you want to get rid of them, and they are easier to be destroyed. So let's say you have some small helper functions, whatever variables your names you are defining in those functions, you want them to be collected as soon as they are finished. So the helper function, you can call it multiple times, right? That's what this does. So generation 0, 1, 2, all the newly created objects are stored in generation 0. So what I was talking about, generation zero, we have, let's say, we have already stored many objects. As soon as the generational garbage collection kicks in, let's say, it has a threshold for each generation. So as soon as the threshold hits, it will run the garbage collector. If the, let's say, generation zero, all the objects, there were 700 objects, and we have removed, let's say, 600 objects. The rest of the objects will move on to generation one. So if generation one threshold hits, it will run garbage collector on that one, and generation zero, all the lower generations as well. And it, whatever objects are collected, it will move to generation two. So I'll quickly go over it. Only container objects with the reference count will be stored in generation list. So it does not store the regular objects, because regular objects reference counting is already there. It can collect that. And Python runs GC algorithm whenever the object reaches threshold. So how do we get the threshold? We do import GC, that's a built-in module. If we do gc.getThreshold, it will return us the threshold for each generation. So in a tuple, tuple is like generation zero is 700, generation one, 10, generation two, 10. So it makes a list of objects to be discarded. That is from the first step of algorithm mark, then runs the algorithm to detect cyclic reference cycles. If an object has no object outside references, add it to the discard list. Again, it's all part of the mark and marking algorithm, marking stage of the mark and sweep algorithm. When it is done, it will sweep all the objects. And when it happens, like it's let's say running for generation two, it will do it all for generation one as well as generation zero, all the younger generations. So after the cycle finishes, it promotes the, as we already talked about, it promotes the surviving objects from the younger generation, let's say generation zero, to generation one. And objects that are there in the that reach the last generation, generation two, stay in the program memory as long as the program executes. The reason being, if it hasn't been cleaned up in two generations and not by reference counting, then definitely means like this is a global object and you're using it continuously and you want to keep it in memory so that the program still needs it till its execution. So it will keep those objects in memory once they have reached generation two. The reference counting we already talked about. And if there are any cyclic references, you can need to wait for GC to run or you can run it manually. Okay. You can let me know the answer for this question if you have ever observed that, let's say, your Python program is running for a longer period of time. You used, let's say, the del keyword. You used multiple other techniques. You try to keep the program memory short, or let's say the functions also in a shorter, smaller functions with lesser variables, smaller helper, divided it into as much smaller functions as you can. But still, the program memory does not reduce. If you have ever gone to, let's say, a running program and open the task manager or activity monitor and you check the program memory, it still is not reducing. It's somewhere around the same when it was in the beginning or even increasing. So why it does not shrink? The reason is fragmentation. The program, yes, definitely the Python program does not shrink in memory. The reason being, we talked about Python is using heap for storing all the objects. So memory is not, it's not like memory when you're assigning some object, it takes a continuous block. Python can, it's OS memory allocation, it can give a continuous block or it can give some random blocks of memory and assign it like to that reference that all these blocks refer to that single object. So if it's not continuous block, even if it's freed up, it will not be released back to the memory, back to the OS. So I hope you understand the point I'm trying to make. So heap, you have, let's say, 10 blocks, and you removed an object, and it was, like, say, 5 and 8. Then a block at index 5 and index 8 was removed. So it's not continuous. It cannot be released back to the program that it's, like, this memory is free. And again, the memory that is being freed up, Python does not release that memory back to the OS. It keeps that memory back in the heap. So that, let's say, you want you deleted some objects, some references were removed, some memory was freed up in the Python heap, and it will just keep that memory to itself so that whenever there is new object initialization, it can reuse that same freed up memory in the heap, and it does not need to request OS for some additional memory. Some quick optimization. So briefly, like before I move on to this section, we briefly talked about the Python, how objects are stored in Python. Python uses stacks and heaps, and then how the object's reference count is stored, how the garbage collection is run, both reference counting and tracing. And what Python uses is generational, where it runs tracing garbage collector on three generations, generation zero, generation one, generation two. So moving on, first thing is I want to talk about dictionaries versus tuples. So if you ever wonder, like you can do import sys and sys.getSizeOf and give that object, it will give you the memory of that object. So you can see that if I just create an empty dictionary and empty tuple, the size difference, you can see how large it is. An empty dictionary is 248 bytes, whereas an empty tuple is just 56 bytes. So that's why it's this is the new feature in Python 3, dunder slots. Actually, let me move on to terminal. You guys are able to see the terminal, right?
Yep, I can see that. Maybe you can increase the font size.
That's better.
Maybe more. Yeah, fine.
Stick to this. I want to have some additional space on my screen. Okay, class dict. Let's say
Okay, yeah.
dict. And I don't give anything to that class. But, so when I, let's say, initialize an object of this. Right, so I already have this object created. I did not define anything. It's just an empty class, just an object I have created. And whenever, let's say, I can give any number of variables to this dictionary object, sorry, this class object, and I'll just clean the screen. So d dot a equals 1, d dot b equals 2, c, 3 equals 4. So what does it actually do? So all classes maintain a dictionary, so where it can store all these variables that are coming in and the values that it has. So if I want to see the dictionary, d dot dunder dict. You see all the variables that I created, a1, b2, c3, d4, are actually stored into this dictionary. And when I say d dot a, it goes into this dictionary, checks which value matches this name, and this key matches, so it returns that value. D dot a just returns 1. So that is the example. Like I can just give d dot A, B, C equals, let's say, have 100 values over there, and D dot, let me put this as well, this. So D, it's just saying 48 bytes, but if I do D dot, done that. See, 144 bytes is what we have assigned, and it's a part of like Python memory optimization. So it does it. All these objects that I've created, some of them already have the value. So it's like when we load the Python program, we know that whenever a Python terminal is loaded or a Python program is loaded, it already loads modules from sys.paths, right? It loads all the paths. Let me just print that. Clear it out. So all these are the Python paths that I have, and side packages. So it will load modules from there, whichever needs to be loaded as part of the Python program execution. And when it loads them, it will intern those objects. So whichever objects are already there, it will not add memory for those objects into this Python program, into this dictionary that I have created. Now let's slot them. So during the initialization, we have to define the slots, and the slots, it will be a tuple of the entries that we want to keep to this class. So most of the times what happens is, if you create a class, the default is sector dictionary, but we don't wa really want, in production where we have gone, right, we are writing program for a longer period, we know that these are the only attributes that this class is going to have. So let's say it is only supposed to have, it's an image class. So the properties that it will have is, let's say, the width, and I'll just define that. Width, height, so image URL, or let's just say URL. What else do you want to include? For let's say a base image, let's just keep these three, that this is the width of the image that I want to keep. This is the height of the image. This is the URL of that image. And I really don't think I need anything else. Let's say for now that in my production instance, I'm just going to use these three values. That's it. So start demo. Now when I say s dot width, I can just give 10 s dot height. It's a 10 by 10 picture. And let's say I'll not give URL for now. So if I do s dot, before I do s dot, let's say there is a string x equals abc. If I do x dot a equals 1 in a string, it's an attribute error. Basically, that string, this is because x is of type string, so string object has no attribute a. So attribute error basically means like this object that you have, I have, it does not have any attribute of this kind, so I cannot set that value. Similarly, I'll just clear some part of this. So s dot the abc or xyz equals some value, it just gives attribute error. So this class slot demo that I've created, it does not have any attribute xyz. So basically what it means is it restricts the attributes that I can have for this class only to these three. So I cannot have any additional attributes to it. So it will definitely, we already saw that dictionary's memory consumption is more than a tuple. So at the end of the day, and if I do s dot dunder dict, actually does not have any dict. So it only has slots, which is a tuple, width, height, and URL. So I can have only these three values assigned to that instance of that class, and I cannot have any additional instances, saving me some memory in production. So let's say the good example is, I'll talk about a blog that towards the end. The blog talks about an organization which saved or reduced almost 9 GB of RAM of memory consumption for a Python program when they just they didn't do any other change. They just use slots for all their classes because they have some common classes for which they are initializing millions of instances, thousands at least, thousands of instances. And for the, let's say, image also, right? If I define this class slot demo as image, I'll have width, height, and URL. So in our, let's say, a simple application, if I talk about Facebook, how many images will it have? So if I'm just creating any millions of objects over there, definitely I'll end up consuming a lot of memory over there. But if I'm using slots, I'm redefining that memory that don't use a dictionary because I have a fixed size, just use a tuple. And that will reduce the memory size overall without making without me making any major changes. So this is really when to use slots. This is really helpful when you're creating many instances of a single class and you already know in advance what properties that class should have. So this, we have already seen the example. I can only define the values of the of the names that I've given during slots initialization, but I cannot have any random attributes defined during runtime. And it definitely it's tuple, so it is hashed and it gives you faster attribute access. So I recommend this reading on Python tips for slots. Moving on, there is also a module in Python built-in library that is vgriff. So sometimes what happens is we want to keep an object, but we don't want to keep a reference to that object, but we don't want that if this reference is there and the actual object. Let's say I had a equals some dictionary, or let's say response is our name, and it had a response from an API call. So I want to keep that response. I want to maintain a reference to it, but I don't want that if this if the response object is overwritten, or the, let's say I do a response equals of API call XYZ, endpoint XYZ, it returned me the response for XYZ. But then I made the call response equals API call ABC DEF, some endpoint, random endpoint. Now the response name was the same, but the object has changed. So I definitely don't want to keep a reference to that old object, and I want that object to be removed. But I just wanted a weak reference so that I can just use that at some other location. So this is what vgriff is. It creates a reference to that object, a response, but it does not keep it as a strong reference that when, let's say, the actual object response is changed, its reference count is changed, or it's deleted, then I don't want to keep that object in memory just because I have a vgriff to it. So it's useful for implementing caches or mapping holding for larger objects, and it does not keep it alive. Rewinding back, we learned about Python as names, references, and objects, reference counting garbage collection, tracing garbage collection, generational garbage collection. We talked about garbage collection, how it is helpful. It frees up the memory in the Python heap, but keeps it to the Python program. That's why like Python program does not shrink in memory. So it keeps it in a heap itself for further object initialization. Then we talked about dunder slots. Then we talked about vgriff. These are some of the sources that I referred for preparing this talk. Sorry. And These are some of the readings that I would definitely recommend. I'll be sharing this presentation link shortly, and you can connect to this presentation at any point of time. And I think the recording will also be available over YouTube. So the Python module of the week, GC, this blog that I was talking about, where a company just used Python slots and saved 9 GB of RAM. So their production instance was using 25 GB of RAM. They reduced it to 16 GB. That's a big change with just one optimization. And people optimizer, so interning and all, vRef. And before I move on to questions, I'll just take a minute going back to Python console and show a couple of more things. I'll first do vRef. Say I create an object A. I just created a basic dictionary, one, which is like indices 1 to 100. These are the keys, and the values are 0 to 99, just the same value, and minus that index. So, or let me make it even more simple. So it's like duplicate, double the value of that square. So 1, 1, 2, 4, 3, 9, 4, 16. These are the keys that I've defined, right? Simple enough. Now let's, if I do vgref, I did import it. So I do b equals vgref of a. It's been a while that I've been back to this. Sorry. Okay. Well, Python documentation is our best friend, so let me just take a minute. This is the first time I'm trying for dictionaries. I usually do it for class objects. So this is how it's, we create an object and we have the reference. Actually, let's go back and already have D. So we already had the class object created D, which was for dict demo, where we defined ABCD and ABC as a list, which has value till 100. And then I just defined a range of 10, and these values 1, 2, 4. So this is the dictionary that I already have. Now I can create a vgref to it. And assign it to value x. Now this you see, right? So it's a vgref that is created. I'll get the id of x d as well. So it's an hexadecimal and this is an integer, so that's why the difference. But vgref, which is created at this memory address, which is created to this dict demo, right? The dict demo is at this memory address. But now if I just do delete of d, so D is not there anymore. If I do X, it just says that vgref and it's a dead reference. So it does not actually, otherwise if I do, I'll have to create that object again. Let's just quickly do it. Moderators, please let me know if I'm just running over my time. I'll quickly try to wrap it up as soon as I can. story that we have created. And if I, instead of just creating a weak ref, I'll first say AB equals D. So AB is also there, D is also there. Both objects have the same reference. And I just do AB dot A equals 1. We see that same changes reflected to that as well, because it's the same object at the end of the day, right? And now I create a weak ref, ref to D. Initialization is there, and if I do B and for the other object AB, if I do del of D, I'll just clear the console. B is not there, AB is still there. X still exists because the dictionary demo, like this object at this memory address, is still alive. So this dictionary object hasn't died yet. I can still use it because there is already another reference to it. I just, when I did del D, it just removed one reference to that object. It did not garbage collect that object because that object is still there. Now if I do del of AB as well, that just says that weak reference is dead. Remember, we never initialize X as a weak reference to AB. We just initialize it as the object to the name D. So, but again, the reference was created to the memory object, to the memory reference of that object. So that's why when I deleted both of those strong references, so these were strong references, right? D and AB. And when I deleted both of them, it just, the weak ref was no longer required. I can use this weak reference so that I can pass it around to some other objects. Let's say I have some response. I can create a weak reference to it. I can pass on that weak reference to some other locations and use it over there. But as soon as the current object, let's say in the main program, I have response. And in the other threaded program, I just pass its weak reference, weak ref response, right? If I, in the main program, I had the execution going in parallel, and in the threaded program, in the child program, I was using that weak reference. I was just getting using that weak reference to get the values from that API response. But at some other point in the main program, I just overrode that project, overrode that object with some other API call response. So that time, this weak reference is going to die. And I can have a check in my child program that if it was there, I can use it. Otherwise, it was just a cache. It wasn't the actual value. It was just the cache I was using. Right. So at this point, the strong reference goes away. The object is garbage collected, but it does not stop the. So the weak reference does not hold that object in memory. So that's how this weak reference is really helpful. Moving back to the presentation. So these are the things that I quickly wanted to cover. And if you are interested about learning about interning as well, let me just. There is a built-in module this which actually like disassemble. So I'll just quickly show one example. Let's say diff func. Hello world. Pune. Y equals. Hello. Space. Sorry. Both of them as X. Right. So we did X equals hello Python Pune in a single string, Y equals hello space Python Pune, but as a string concatenation. So now if I do print of X comma Y, then I do print of X equals equals Y. Is y comma id of x id of y. I call func. What do you think the expected output is? X and y, again, like it's a basic string concatenation, so definitely it should work. But should the memory address also match? So we talked about Python interning. We talked about how it only does immutable objects. So this time we are doing it runtime. We are concatenating the string. So during the initialization, X was hello Python Pune in a single string. Y was hello space Python Pune, but as a string concatenation. So we are basically concatenating three strings. You can let me know the answer in the YouTube in the stream chat. and we'll come back to that. It's just 2 more minutes.
It started.
Okay. Hey, folks. Welcome back, and sorry for the interruption. So we were just talking about Python sysinterning, system interning. So we talked about like hello Python Pune as in the variable x in a single string. Y equals hello concatenate with the space, another string space with the third string Python Pune. And we did x comma y, so hello Python Pune, hello Python Pune. X equals equals y, the value matches, but ID also matches. So you must be wondering, like during runtime, it was supposed to concatenate, right? It wasn't like when I initialized, the values were x equals in a single string, y was a concatenation of three strings. So hello space Python Pune, but still it matched. If you ever want to check how it is working, we just talked about like this DIS. It's a Python built-in module. If I do dis.dis func, or let me scroll back. So this is a disassembler for Python. How you can see what is being happening inside the Python program in the memory. So when I did load constant, when I did first a program x equals hello Python Pune. So this was 0 and then 1. This was the first step that happened. So load constant, it created a constant hello Python Pune. And stored it in the variable name x. Then I did y equals hello space, hello plus space plus Python Pune. But then Python always compiles it into bytecode, right? During that bytecode compilation, it will take some memory optimization and do this part. So that's why it was stored as a single string hello Python Pune during bytecode compilation. That's why the strings match, because it did not happen at runtime actually. It happened during bytecode compilation. So this was formed into a single string. It sees, loads that constant, stores it. And now that this string was already there, it will use that intern string and not create another object in memory. Then we did print x and y, load global, load fast. So we did store fast of x and y. Then I did load x and y, call that function, pop that value at the top. So it called print, whatever the value was, it will store in a stack. It will pop that top value and push it on the console. Similarly, print x, y, and then compare operation was equal equals. So it will do that, call that function, pop that value from the top. All those values are, whenever we are calling print, it is pushing it into a stack, the values, and it will pop those values and print it. I mean, we have rarely seen this kind of thing happening, like pop and stack push for print, because most of the time when we have ran our Python programs, it will print that real time. But I have a Python program that I wrote for running a pipeline in AWS, and that pipeline, that script that I was running, it was running from a GitLab runner and a Kubernetes runner via the GitLab CI pipeline. So what I also observed was, even if I'm doing print, it was just keeping them in the stack. So I have real-time printing, but it did not print anything real-time. The script was running for 30 minutes. At the end of the script, when everything ran, it just popped everything from the top and printed everything on the console in just one single go. So that also happens sometimes. It depends on like how the Python program is running and in which configuration. Then we talked about Python X, Y, is, we are doing the is comparison. And then moving on, X, ID of Y. So that's what I just wanted to briefly talk to you about this function, that how disassembler, you can see all that is happening inside a function line by line in terms of memory consumption.
Jatin, can you try resharing your screen? Yeah.
Okay. Let me know when you are able to see the terminal.
I can see, should be visible on live stream as well. You can continue.
Okay. So
yeah.
I'll just
try. Maybe you can briefly talk what you showed.
Yes.
Or just scroll up and show it. Yeah.
So we already talked about func, where we defined x and y as these strings and hello Python Pune. Or let me just write it again so that everyone is able to follow. At this time, I'm going to use some ASCII characters. Okay, So x equals hello Python Pune, and in a single string y equals hello plus space plus Python Pune plus the double exclamation. So now if I do x, okay, I'll just change it and equals. X equals equals y. This is the function that I have defined. X equals hello Python Pune, y hello Python Pune, same with exclamation, but the only difference is x is at runtime, it's initialized into a single string. Y is a concatenation of all these multiple strings to form that same value. So we print x and y, x equals equals y, x is y, id of x, id of y. We already seen have seen in the earlier example, I had the same function, but without the exclamation towards the end for both the strings. So what do you think is going to be the value of x is y this time? Well, this time it's going to be 4. What? Okay, this is a surprise for me as well. SKI characters usually does not enter. Maybe it's with some latest version that it has been addressed. Okay, let's see the disassemble then. We already see that the value is matching. The ID also matches. The index also matches. Let's see the disassembler now. If you are ever in doubt, you can disassemble that function and see what is happening. There we see. So we see hello Python Pune was done over here, and hello Python Pune, when we did y, it compiled it at runtime and it stored that as a string over here. So x, y, x is y, it does that match and it actually returns true now. Okay, that's more or less that I had to show from my side with slots, vgriff, and disassembler, that how you can disassemble a Python function to see what is happening inside its memory and like what all inside a function, how the initializations and everything is happening. I think I can take questions now. I have already run over time, I believe.
Yeah, you can go ahead with the questions. You can just switch the screen and show the questions however you want. Yeah.
All right. So first question from Kanishk. What is a good indicator that my Python program needs memory optimization discussed here? So it's not like a good indicator that you have need to have some indication. In my opinion, like, it does not need to have some indication when your Python program is already running. It's something that we strongly feel that we should include in our development process. So whenever we are actually developing a Python program, we should know about these practices, how Python's memory is being managed, how memory management is done inside a Python program, so that we can design our Python program during during development, so it can optimize it automatically. Remember, we don't want to do premature optimization. That's one thing. We definitely don't want to spend too much time optimizing in the initial stages, that we lose our track and delay our development, overall development as well. But it's good to know about these practices so that, let's say, during development time, you can think about, should I initialize this object really in the global namespace, or should I initialize it in the local namespace? These kind of smaller practices. But when your Python program needs memory optimization is when you are close to, let's say, your first release, you are already seeing that people are going to like it and it's going to production. Maybe I should spend some time on whether it should be done right now, or is it something that I still have some features that I want to deliver? It's up to, it depends again. Situation to situation. Sometimes you have a smaller program that you can feel like, I can add some features to it right now and I will have time to come back to it. But now is better than never. Sorry. There is a Zen of Python, right? Zen of Python. I really like those two lines. So right now is later than, never is later than right now. Yep, so now is better than never, although never is often better than right now. So that's what, we definitely want to do it now so that it does not have to be like it will never happen in future. So if you are thinking, if you know that this program, even if you come back to it, you will never have time to invest time on it to optimize it in terms of CPU and memory, then you better do it during the development itself. But if you know that this is going to delay my entire development itself and my miss my timelines, or like something it's going to cause some hazardous issues, then better we push it for some delay and then plan it accordingly. So again, it depends situation to situation. What is the time that you feel, I don't want to be imposing something that this is the best time, that after development, when you're doing your first release, before that you do it. I don't want to impose that. It depends on situation to situation. But you get, I hope you get the overall gist that when you should try and invest time on it. Okay. Moving on, so Python labor tool to investigate memory usage. So I personally use Python's this like I have been long using Python's if you know Anaconda distribution. It comes with Spider IDE. So Spider IDE, there is a built-in profiler that it has. There is also C profile as a built-in profiler in into C Python that you can run on a Python program, and it will give you the profiling of that Python program, which includes what are the CPU cycles, like time that it includes for each memory call, or like, sorry, each function call, variable assignment, and everything. Similarly, it also shows what is the memory being consumed by each function or class. I personally use Spider's profiling, which is like when you run that profiler, it shows you how in a tabular format, what is the time that it took for each function call, what is the memory it took. So those are the ones that I have personally used. I don't know about any other tools that are there out there, but I think there are already a lot of tools that you can take a look at. If you want command line, I just use CPython, C profile. If I want Spider, like you know, IDE, I'm doing some development and I want to do it actively at, during the development time itself, I just run the profiler on Spider.
Any there other is an, questions? Yeah, there is another question. Just give me a minute. It's sure. A long one, so I won't be able to read it completely. So I will just share my screen again.
Okay. Yeah, okay, that's a good question. Yeah, that's a good question. So cons of using slots is definitely if you know that you want to have some, if you are going to add some variable assignment or like attribute assignment to that class at runtime, then definitely slots is not going to fit your program, because it is going to give you attribute error and it will cause your program to crash if you do not do that exception handling. So it's good to know that which class you are going to use and like for slots, which class you are going to use slots for, and whether it's going to be like having those static attributes only. It's not going to have any attributes initialized during runtime. If you inherit from a class having slots, can you add new attributes? So yes, I can show it to you right now if the time permits, or maybe we can connect later on. But what I did as a test example was I created a class A, let's say A, I defined slots and I had three attributes A, B, C as part of it. Then I initialized two classes. One is class B that inherits from A, and I just did pass, so no other initialization. Now what happens is B has a dictionary by default, right? Because B is a new class that is being created, although it is inheriting from A. So B, I can have dictionary as well as slots. So it has mix and match of both. So I mean, again, coming back to your questions, cons of using slots. So if you think there is a case that you want to have slots as fixed attributes, but also want to be able to use some dictionary for some dynamic attributes, you can use inheritance over there. But then I created another class C where I defined slots equals XYZ. And it was also inheriting from A. So A has slots ABC, B, C has slots XYZ. I can have all these six attributes, but I cannot have anything outside of these six. So that is also there. I hope that answers your question and it does not complicate too much. And I mean, we can come back to this and I can show it on the Python terminal again if you want, but maybe we can take some other questions if they are.
Maybe we can wait for a few seconds and then we can conclude.
Sure. I know this is too much to learn for one single day, but again, this gives you an overall gist of how Python Memory Manager works and how you can use it in your day-to-day work and optimize your Python programs to make it better. So of course, this will also address if many of you are trying competitive programming, sometime or the other, I bet you have seen the memory limit exceeded error on any single program at least once in your lifetime. That's what I can bet on. So if you have seen those errors, knowing about this definitely will help you grow in that perspective, that how you can optimize your Python program so that it meets the time, it solves the problem, and it does not exceed the memory limit.
Cool. I guess we don't have any more questions.
Perfect. So my Twitter handle is _JatinGoyal. So it will be shared in the presentation as well. I'll send the link to the Python Pune team and they can circulate it. So you can always reach out to me over Twitter for any other questions or anything at all.
Yep. The issue where Jatin proposed the talk, which is like proposal, there you can reach out to him also. So,
yep.